गुड मॉर्निंग वन एंड ऑल। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द चैप्टर एटॉमिक स्ट्रक्चर। फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज द फर्स्ट यूनिट फ्रॉम द केमिस्ट्री पेपर नंबर 4 ऑफ बीएससी फर्स्ट ईयर। नाउ इन दिस चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द पॉइंट्स इंट्रोडक्शन, रदरफोर्ड्स अल्फा पार्टिकल स्कैटरिंग एक्सपेरिमेंट, रदरफोर्ड्स एटॉमिक मॉडल, इट्स ड्रॉबैक्स, इन ब्लैक बॉडी रेडिएशन, प्लैंक्स रेडिएशन लॉ, बोर्स थियरी ऑफ हाइड्रोजन एटम, बोर्स एटॉमिक मॉडल, इट्स पॉस्टुलेट्स, मेरिट्स एंड डिमेरिट्स एटसेट्रा एंड रिमेनिंग पॉइंट्स दैट विल बी कवर्ड इन द नेक्स्ट वीडियो। नाउ लेट अस सी हियर, द फर्स्ट वन इज द डाल्टन्स एटॉमिक थियरी। सो जॉन डाल्टन इन 1808 regarding the structure of matter, he explained the laws of chemical combination. And the main assumptions of this theory are: the matter is composed of extremely small particles called atoms, and these atoms cannot be subdivided by means of any chemical reaction or by chemical means. These atoms can neither be created nor be destroyed. It means atoms cannot be created or destroyed. Its next assumption is atoms of the same element are identical in all respects. It means they are identical in shape, size, weight, and properties. But the atoms of the different elements are dissimilar in weight and properties. Next assumption, that is the atoms of different elements combine in simple whole numbers like 1 is to 1, 1 is to 2, 2 is to 1, 2 is to 3, etc. to form the compound atoms known as molecules. For example, suppose HCl, that is a hydrochloric acid, it is the example of 1 is to 1 combination. Then water molecule, that is the H2O. That is the example of 2 is to 1 combination. So these are the important assumptions of Dalton's atomic theory. Now the next important point is here, Rutherford's alpha particle scattering experiment. So Ernest Rutherford in 1909 explained the atomic model by performing his historic alpha particle scattering experiment. So along with Marstein, he performed the experiment, that is in the year 1909, Ernest Rutherford and Marstein explained the atomic model by performing their historic alpha particle scattering experiment, which is shown here. So here, this is the lead box in which the source of this alpha particle is kept, and this is the beam of alpha particle which is allowed to fall on this thin gold foil, and this gold foil that is covered by the circular fluorescent zinc sulfide screen. Now these alpha particles, they get penetrated through these foils. Some alpha particles get deflected and falls on this zinc sulfide screen and forms the flash of light. So from this we can say that in this particular experiment, the fast moving alpha particles were allowed to strike a thin gold foil, and this Rutherford selected this gold foil because he wanted as thin a layer as possible. This gold foil was about 1000 atoms thick. The alpha particles are fast moving and doubly charged helium ions, and they have mass of 4 unit and considerable amount of energy. So this Rutherford was expected that alpha particles would be deflected by subatomic particles in the gold atoms. Since the alpha particles are much heavier than the protons, he did not expect to see large deflections. So let us see the observations of this alpha particle scattering experiment, and these are the observations means most of the alpha particles they passed straight, means they are undeflected particles. Some alpha particles were deflected by Weyl. Now let's see, these are the alpha particles, they get deflected, and this is the slight deflection, slightly deflected alpha particle, and very few alpha particles were deflected, and their deflection is found to be large, and very few or very very few means about 1 out of every 12,000 particles alpha particle appear to rebound, means go back. So these are the observations. Now see here, the most of the fast moving alpha particle passed through the gold foil, and some of the alpha particles were deflected by the foil by small angles, and very few or very small number of alpha particles deflected by large angles, and 1 out of every 12,000 alpha particles appeared to rebound. So these are the important observations of this Rutherford's alpha particle scattering experiment, and on the basis of these observations he has drawn some conclusions, and the important conclusions are here. The most of the space inside the atom is empty because most of the alpha particles passed straight through the gold foil without getting deflected. So first conclusion is most of the space inside the atom is empty. Why? Because most of the alpha particles passed through the gold foil without getting deflected. So this is the first conclusion. Now second conclusion is very few alpha particles were deflected from their path, and this indicates that the positive charge of the atom occupies very little space. So this is the second conclusion. Now the next conclusion is very few small fraction of alpha particles were deflected by 180 degree, and this indicates that all positive charge and mass of the gold atom were concentrated in a very small volume within the atom. Now next important point is here Rutherford's atomic model. Now in this Rutherford's atomic model, according to Rutherford, an atom consists of minute positively charged body located at the center, which is called nucleus, and in this nucleus entire mass of the atom is concentrated. Next point is here, the mass of atom is almost entirely due to protons, and therefore all the protons are present in the nucleus. And here the third important point is an equal number of extremely small negatively charged electrons distributed around the nucleus to balance the positive charge. So these are the three important points which are given by Rutherford. So this is nothing but Rutherford's atomic model, and it is based on the alpha particle scattering experiment. Now the structure of this atom according to Rutherford is this one. This is the positively charged nucleus which is at the center, and electrons are orbiting or revolving around the nucleus. So these electrons may orbit in this particular direction also, or in this particular direction also. But this atomic model has some limitations or drawbacks. So the important drawbacks of this Rutherford's atomic model are, first one is Rutherford could not explain how electrons and protons could be close packed to form a stable nucleus. And next one, the assumption, one of the assumption of Rutherford is that the electrons were orbiting about the nucleus was unfortunate. Unfortunate means the electrons which are orbiting or revolving around the nucleus, they continuously radiate energy. It means they will undergo this spiral motion, and finally they will fall or collapse into this nucleus. But in actual practice, it is not happening. So this was the unfortunate. The revolving of or orbiting of electron about the nucleus was unfortunate. In other words, we can say that the electron moving with acceleration must continuously lose energy and eventually will fall into the nucleus, which is contrary to the fact, means it is actually not happening. Rutherford's model says nothing about the electronic structure of atom. It means how electrons are distributed around the nucleus or what are the energies of these electrons that are not explained by Rutherford's atomic model. And last one, it is possible to have infinite number of orbits, but in actual practice it is not the case. So these are the important drawbacks or limitations of Rutherford's atomic model. Now let us see here the important point, that is the black body radiation. A black body is an object that absorbs all the radiations falling on it, and a perfect black body or perfect absorber is also a perfect emitter of radiation. So this is the important point we have to keep in mind. Thus, all bodies heated to a given temperature, means when more than one bodies we have and all they are heated to a given temperature, then we will find that the maximum energy is radiated by black body. So the energy density is nothing but the amount of energy radiated per unit volume. So the energy density by a black body depends upon the temperature, and the correlation between energy density and wavelength for black body radiation at different temperatures is shown in figure like this one. So this is the diagram that shows the plot between energy density against this wavelength. Now this diagram has some characteristics, or these curves have some characteristics. First one is, for each temperature there is a particular wavelength at which the energy radiated is maximum. Now see carefully this diagram. For each temperature, first of all see, this is the 3000 Kelvin temperature, and at this temperature the wavelength is this one. At this particular wavelength the energy density is maximum. For 4000 Kelvin the wavelength is shifted to the left hand side, means towards the lower value, and this is the energy density at 4000 Kelvin. At 5000 Kelvin the wavelength is shifted to the lower value, means that is to the left side, and here is the energy density value. And at 6000 Kelvin again wavelength is shifted to the left hand side or to the lower value, and its energy density value is this one, that is the maximum. So these are the important characteristics, means for each temperature there is a particular wavelength at which the energy radiated is maximum. Now see, the position of maximum shifts towards the lower wavelength with increase in temperature. This wavelength for this temperature, when temperature goes on increasing, it shifts to the lower side, means to the left hand side with increase in temperature. Means higher the temperature, more pronounced is the maximum. Means with increase in temperature, the energy density radiated, that will be maximum. And these curves are known as black body radiation curves. Now the next point is here, Planck's radiation law. It is also known as quantum theory of heat radiation. So this theory is put forth in 1901 by Planck, and according to this theory, the radiant energy is emitted or absorbed discontinuously in the form of teeny bundles. Teeny means very small bundles, and these bundles have energy. So teeny bundles of energy, and they are known as the quanta, or they are also known as photons. Means energy radiated or energy absorbed, that is discontinuously, and that is in the form of small bundles, which are known as quanta or photon. Small bundles of the energy, quanta or photon are the small bundles of energy. Means energy is radiated or absorbed discontinuously in the form of quanta or photon. And each quantum or photon is associated with definite amount of energy, and that is nothing but E is equal to h into mu, where E is the energy in joules and mu is the frequency of radiation, and it is in reciprocal second or per second, we can say that here. H is the fundamental constant, and it is known as Planck's constant. Its value is 6.626 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule second. And the value of quanta or photon, or the value of quanta or photon energy, is also calculated by using another formula, that is E is equal to hc into mu bar, where mu bar is the wave number, and this wave number is nothing but the reciprocal of wavelength. So it can be shown like this: mu bar is equals to 1 by lambda, but we know that this wave number, that is mu, or the we can say that the frequency, it is equal to c by lambda. So this is equal to c into mu bar, or we have this equation, that is E is equal to hc into mu bar. So this is the important equation that is used to calculate the amount of energy of photon. Now the body, any one body that can emit or absorb energy in the form of photon, and they are always in whole numbers, multiple of quanta or photon, that is 1 h mu, 2, 3 up to n h mu. Means a body can emit or absorb energy only in whole numbers of multiples of the quanta or photon. And energy of fraction of quantum cannot be lost or absorbed, and this is known as the quantization of energy. Based on this theory, Planck's radiation theory, or based on this theory, Planck's obtained the following expression for the energy density of black body radiation. This expression is E mu dv equal to 8 pi h mu cube upon c cube into dv upon exponential of hp kt raised to minus 1. And Planck was awarded the physics Nobel Prize in the year 1918 for propounding the quantum theory of radiations. Now let's see Bohr's model of hydrogen atom. Niels Bohr in 1913 retained the essential features of the Rutherford's model of the atom. And in order to account for the stability of the atom, he introduced the concept of stationary and non-radiating orbits. It means Bohr retained the essential or important features of Ruther's model of the atom, and he introduced the new concept for the stability of the atom, and he introduced the concept of stationary, or we can say that non-radiating orbits. So Bohr's theory was based on Planck's quantum theory and was built on the following postulates. So the important postulates of the Bohr's model or Bohr's atomic theory are here. First one is that an atom consists of positively charged nucleus responsible for almost the entire mass of the atom, and electrons revolve around the nucleus in certain permitted circular orbits of definite radii known as stationary or non-radiating orbits. The permitted orbits are those which, or for which, the angular momentum of an electron is an integral multiple of h by twice pi, where h is the Planck's constant having value 6.625, 6.626 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule second. So the important postulates of Bohr's atomic theory are here: an atom consists of positively charged nucleus, and that is responsible for the entire mass of the atom. Second possibility is electrons are revolving around the nucleus in certain permitted circular orbits having definite radii, and these orbits are known as stationary or non-radiating orbits. And these permitted orbits are those for which the angular momentum of an electron is an integral multiple of h by twice pi. So these are the important postulates of Bohr's atomic theory. Now let's see some examples. First example is here: if m is the mass and phi is the velocity of electron in a permitted orbit of radius r, then the angular momentum L is equals to m phi r, or that is equal to n into h by twice pi, where n is the principal quantum number and its value that will be 1, 2, 3, etc. So here L indicates the angular momentum, and the corresponding energy level n is called the principal quantum number. So this equation number 1, it is called Bohr's quantization postulate. Thus, when an electron move in a permitted discrete orbits, then they do not radiate energy, and such orbits are called stationary or non-radiating orbits. And the energy radiated, the energy in the form of quantum photon, is radiated when an electron jumps from higher energy level to lower energy level, or higher orbit to lower orbit. And energy is absorbed. Energy is absorbed when the electron jumps from the lower energy level to higher energy level, or lower orbit to higher orbit. Thus, quantum or photon of energy absorbed or emitted is the difference between the lower and higher energy levels or orbits of the atom. Therefore, this delta is equal to higher energy level minus lower energy level, or that will be equals to h mu. Delta is equal to h mu. Suppose this is equation number 2. In this way, the electron move in permitted discrete orbits, and in that particular orbit electron do not radiate energy, and such orbits are called the stationary or non-radiating orbits. And the energy in the form of quanta or photon is radiated when electron jumps from higher to lower orbit, and energy is absorbed when electron jumps from lower to higher orbit. And the quantum or photon of energy absorbed or emitted is calculated using this formula, that is the difference between the lower and higher energy levels of the atom, or that is nothing but delta is equal to h mu. So the equation number 2, that is called here the Bohr's frequency condition, and here h is the Planck's constant and mu is the frequency of photon emitted or photon absorbed. Now diagrammatically it can be shown like this. So these are the circular orbits 1, 2, 3. This indicates the orbit numbers. This is the nucleus. So circular orbits or stationary energy levels in an atom, it is shown here. And electrons are, these are the electrons that are permitted in circular orbits, and electrons are not allowed between these orbits. So we can say that these are the orbits, or you can say that the energy levels 1, 2, 3. And electrons can radiate energy, means photon is absorbed when electron jumps from lower to higher energy level. Hence, energy is increased and electron jumps from higher energy level to lower energy level. The photon is emitted. It means energy is decreased. Thus, an electron absorbs a photon of light while it jumps from a lower to higher energy orbit, and a photon is emitted when the electron returns to the original level. So in this way, today we are studied Dalton's atomic theory, Rutherford's alpha particle scattering experiment. In brief, Rutherford's atomic model and its drawback, black body radiation. Then we have studied Planck's radiation law, then Bohr's theory of hydrogen atom, and finally Bohr's atomic model, its postulates, merits and demerits. Remaining part of this chapter that will be covered in next video. So thank you for watching the complete video. Stay home, stay safe, stay healthy and stay happy. So keep watching the video. So thank you once again for watching the complete video.